So I am currently working as a senior software engineer in one industry, and I am into Android from last 5 years. And I write articles on the problems I face during Android development. So you can find that on Medium.
I'm Anuj, and I've been working on Android for the last 10 years. I work with Abhishek on organizing this meetup as well, so ADG-Delhi. How many of you are beginners or like fresh Android, junior Android developers here? So this talk is perfect for you. We're going to talk about unit testing, a very important part of software development, which is not really practiced much in Android for various reasons. Primarily because the Android architecture, where the system system always instantiates your activity classes, it was not always very well suited for writing tests. But now with the new architecture components, Google has been pushing. Things have become much easier, and so that's why we're here today talking about unit testing on Android. Let me just go through the agenda for the talk. We'll start with introduction to app architectures and unit tests. Then the tools and frameworks that are available. Then we'll talk about how you can architect or how you can write code which is inherently more testable, easier to test. And then we'll finish off with a demo. So Niharika will start with introducing the app architecture.
Android developers, we are getting updates in technology every single day, like to make our code more better and better. So if I ask you guys, what does this clean or good code base mean to you? Can anyone explain that? What for you is good or clean code base?
I try to implement some clean architecture code. So, in clean architecture, specifically the code which we write is generally is monolog. Means in a one single file we write all the logic of networking, business logic, plus UI emulation. That is the activity part. So, if we divide it into several files, making it more coupling and testable. That's what the clean architecture is.
So there's a difference between clean architecture and a clean code base.
Solid and readable and most probably maintainable. But that's the second part first.
Really and maintainability comes as a side effect out of it.
Yeah.
I can summarize a good code clean code base as scalable, stable, testable, and modular, right? Everyone is familiar with these terms. So, to achieve these, we have some architectures in the market. We have different architectures there. Let me explain you some. We have MP patterns. Everyone has heard about them, right? So, with model, you can have the network layer in database operations. View is for displaying the data. Earlier we had MVC, where controller was doing the editing manipulation of data, and our activities and fragments were acting as view and controller both.
Yeah.
Then came MVP. The presenter was there acting as a mediator between your view and the model, and handling all the business logic there. Then came the view model. Now with presenter, every presenter is having the reference for the view, right? Whenever you have some presenter, you will passing the reference of the view there. So every view is mapped to one presenter, and but there is one-to-one mapping there. With view model, we had this advantage that many views can be mapped to one view model. As we have the live data observer sheets there, you just have to observe in your activities your local code. So now, there are many others. Clean architecture, MVR architectures, so you can follow any of those. So, MVC, MVP, MVVM, which one to follow? Which are you guys following?
MVP.
Why? Because the company was doing that. when you switch to that company, then
mentality is easy, man. Like when you go for MVP, then we have make every interface for every view and presenter. In that case, we don't have to make interface, so code base is small. That's why you go for MVP. Lots of things are easier, man.
I like the reactive nature of the data, how you can react to just the changes in data model. You don't have to write much logic in your view layer, it just has to react to your data.
Right.
Making view passive and spitting out the presentation logic and then taking care of the business logic. That's, I think, it's very better with combination of MVP and MVP.
So that's the view model architecture component, and not the view model as a design pattern.
Yeah. Okay. So in my opinion, no architecture is bad if that fulfills your intentions and requirements. So there's one line from Uncle Ho. Have you heard about that name?
Yes.
Okay. So there's line there. Your architecture should only be about the intentions, not about the framework. That means your architecture should tell about what are you going to build, not about how are you going to build. Let me give you an example for that. If you're building a house, what does an architect do? You'll be having a blueprint for a building, that there will be a door there, then a room, the washroom, there's a lobby there. So these are the intentions for a building there. But what kind of brick are you going to use? What kind of cement are you going to use? We make these decisions to be on house owner, right? So how are you going to build? That doesn't matter. That shouldn't matter there. So your ideal architecture should only tell about the intentions, not about the frameworks. So for applications, your activities, fragments, and views should be business logic free. That should be there for only displaying the data. So if your architecture is fulfilling that, then you're good to go. And the other thing is, your architecture should be testable. If you are able to test each and every small use case for a feature you are going to build, then you can say that that architecture is a testable architecture. So now, I told you that we have small use cases. And there's a term in Android for that, small use cases, that is unit test. Unit means small, and if I combine that with the code, the smallest testable part of an application, that are classes and methods, which we are going to test to determine whether they are fit to use or not. So this is the term unit testing there. There's an anatomy for a unit test. Whenever we write a unit test, we follow this principle, this triple principle. That is, arrange, act, and assert. Arrange all the necessary conditions, then act on the object, and assert what are the expected results there. For example, I am going to log in with email and password, and after that successful login, I will be redirecting to home screen. For doing login, email and password are my preconditions. I need that. After that, I will be doing login. That is my action. That is the act. After successful login, I will be going to home screen with some data. So that is my expected result. So every unit test works on this triple E principle. So if you are going to do unit testing, you will be having some advantages from that. You'll be able to find the problems early. Before your code goes live in production, if you are testing each and every small use case, then you'll be confident about your code. Facilitate refactoring. If I tell you about my experience, we had some legacy code, and when we started doing unit testing for that, we found many incorrect initializations, some duplicacy of code. So yes, refactoring becomes easy when you are doing you are doing test, writing test for small cases. If you are testing for small cases, then your integration testing becomes easy. After doing unit testing for each small case, you can document that out easily, as you know each and every part of your application. So we have categorized, Android has categorized unit tests into two types: instrumented unit tests and Docker unit tests. You must have seen two folders under your source: Android test and test folder. So instrumented tests are those for if you are doing UI or UX testing. So we call that as instrumented testing, and we do that on device itself, device or emulator, and you can find those tests under Android test folder. Or also in Gradle, we have Android test implementation and test implementation return. So that Android test, if you are writing something with Android test implementation, that Gradle works with Android test folder, and that test implementation is for your local unit test under the test folder. Our local unit test runs on the Java virtual machine, and if you are running something on JVM, that will be faster than the test running on Android itself. There's no need of device or emulator. Also, in today's talk, we will be having the demo for local unit test. There are some tools and frameworks available for unit testing. Obviously, there will be something there. So, these are GUnit, Mockito, PowerMock, Global Electric, Espresso, and UI Automator. These last two are for the Android part, Android UI UX testing there. Whenever we start a new project, you'll be seeing this Gradle already by default there. So this is the GUnit Gradle dependency there. These are some annotations which we will be using for testing. Just go through these. We'll be explaining them in demo itself. These are some statements which we'll be checking for the expected and actual results. So now with JUnit, there come some limitations. Let's say I have some, if I have to do some calculation testing as 1 plus 1, I can see the expected and actual result. Now you are testing a class, and that has some external dependency. Like I have to read some data from file, or I have to perform some database operation. I have some interaction with the model class. So, but Android says, see, if you are testing one class, you should focus on one class. That if you are testing the business logic for the presenter, you should focus on the presenter only or view model only. So you have to fake those objects, as you need those external dependencies there. JUnit can't fulfill that. So we switch to another framework, that is Mockito, so that you can mock or fake that object in your test class. This was the reason we had external dependencies, as reading from file or database operations. This is the Gradle for that. With Mockito, we can do these operations: mocking, stubbing, argument matchers, verifying the calls, how many times the call is getting invoked, and verifying the order in which methods are getting called. When you see the live demo, you will be relating these there. I'll be explaining them even. So with every clause, there are some cons with every framework. With Mockito, you can't mock final classes. You will be having your everyone is having different requirements. So you must be having some static classes or a class with some static methods, final classes, or a class with final methods, and you have to use those methods. You can't do those with Mockito. Yeah, but yes, with Mockito 2, we have an experiment that we can mock the final methods or final classes now, but that is an experimental phase. We have that as an opt-in feature right now. They are just seeing if people are using, they will add that in the Mockito library. So for mocking these final classes, final methods, private or constructors, we use PowerMock. we should avoid this. But yes, if you are having some libraries or you are having some classes with some setting methods, as like your utility classes, you have some setting methods there, right? And you can't do anything. Otherwise, you will be writing your everywhere the same code and using that. So you have to use your utility classes. So you'll be using PowerMock there. These are the you can have the latest version. Maybe this is these are now older. Now comes the RoboElectric. So as JVM is faster than your Android device testing. So and you want some inflation of views. So you want to test some inflation of views. You want some resource loading. You can do that on your JVM itself by mocking Android jar classes and using shadow objects from them, shadow classes. You will be using shadow classes there, and you can easily run that on your JVM. As JVM don't know about your Android mock classes, so you have to mock somewhere with some framework. So we use RoboElectric for that. You can just handle the inflation of views, resource loading, and the code implemented in native C code, but you can't perform any interaction. You can't see the Android component interacting. As like with Android UI or UX testing, if you have some button click or you are scrolling something, what happens? If you have to test these kind of things, you have to go for the UI or UX testing, that instrumented test itself. Yeah. So now we know the unit testing, the features, the type of unit testing, the advantages of unit testing. So before we go to the demo, we should know how to write a testable code. What mistakes we should avoid so that you can test your code after or before that. So Anuj will be explaining that.
Thanks, Niharika. So writing testable code, most Android developers think it's hard, right? Writing tests can be hard, right? But is it because we as Android developers don't know some secret sauce about writing unit tests, or because our Android framework doesn't provide any tools for writing unit tests, or is it because our code is inherently not architected or written in a way that it is more testable? So I'm going to argue that it is the second case, and writing tests is as simple on Android as it is on any other platform. And in fact, we'll see that most of our unit tests will be so simple that you'll think, wow, why I didn't do it before. So when done right, unit tests result in a code base which is clean, which is maintainable, and which sparkles. Before that, let's see what is a good unit test. A good unit test is basically which is easy to write, because you'll be writing hundreds of these. So it should not seem like a chore. It should seem like a natural thing to do. It should be readable, because it is sort of your documentation for your code as well. It should be reliable. It should not be if I run it in the morning, it runs, but if I run it in the evening, it doesn't. It should not be that if I run it as alone, independently, it works, but if I run it as part of a test suite, it fails. It should be fast, because it should run as part of my complete, every time I push my code to Git, it should run. And it should be truly unit. Now, what does that mean? As a unit, so whenever you're testing something, you're testing a system. That is called a system under test. Now, when I'm writing a unit test, I should only be testing that one particular unit and not anything that else that it depends on. So Mockito, as Niharika introduced, is used to mock out everything else, so that I'm actually just testing what is my system. So this is an example of a good unit test. If you read its name, it's basically function that is valid, is email valid? What is the condition for valid email? What should it return? Returns true. So it's a readable unit test. The arrange, act, and assert, as Niharika had said. So I set up my input values. I call a function and then I assert the answer. So most of a unit test should be as simple as this, and that's the only then can you write hundreds and thousands of these. Now coming to writing testable code, what are the characteristics of a testable code? A testable code should be deterministic in nature. A function that behaves differently at on subsequent runs, you can never write a unit test for that, or it's very difficult to write it. So for example, we have this login function that almost all our applications have. Now in this, what I'm doing is I am first checking if there's an active network connection or not, and if there is, then I'm performing some action. Is this deterministic? What does it depend on? So it will behave differently if there is a network connected or not, correct? Now if I had to write a unit test for this, then I'll have to do something in my setup method. I'll set up the network state to what I want it to be. Then I'll run my actual test, and then in the teardown method, I'll reset the network state to what it was before. Now this is a very difficult code to write. For every test I write, if I have to set up these initial states and I have to reset these states, it's going to become a chore. I'll not write these tests. So, and then it's not fast, because all of this is extra work is going on. And then it's not reliable. Why? Because my device might fail when I'm trying to set its network state. Maybe the network card is occupied somewhere. Maybe there's some other problem. Maybe I don't even have a network card on my device. So it's not reliable. So that's why it's not a good unit test. How could I make this better? So a better login function is basically inversion of control, as dependency injection talks tell you. Basically, what it needs as an outside dependency, it's passed as a parameter. So there's an interface called network utils that tells if the network is connected or not. And using this, I can now mock this network utils using, or create a dummy implementation which returns what I want. It's now fairly simple. It does exactly the same thing that the previous implementation was doing. But there is still a problem with this function. Can anybody guess?
Perform login is dependent upon network.
Yeah, but I'm providing that in my unit test. So like, I'm providing a dummy implementation. So it is now completely under my control. Static method, that is a different thing, but static method which behaves consistently, which is a pure function, is fine. So the problem is that the dependency on an outside non-determinism has now been shifted up to a higher method. So now the method which was calling it, now that function is non-deterministic. So I cannot test that function. So if I had to write a better unit test for this, dependency injection. So if I can inject my network utils into my main class and then use that, that would be the best way. So, yeah, next one. Now, non-determinism arises mostly when you are interacting with the real world. But sometimes in our code, we can unknowingly add non-determinism. So, can you just take a look at this code and guess why this is non-deterministic? This is basically taking the array, adding all the elements of the array to a hash set, and then returning the first element from the hash set. So a hash set does not guarantee order. So the set.first will behave differently on different machines. On a single machine, it will still behave the same. On different machines, it will not. So we just have to be careful when writing our code that not only when we are interacting with the real world, but even in certain ways, non-determinism can be added, inserted into our code. So whenever you're writing code, make sure that it's deterministic as much as possible. The second important property of testable code is that it should be side effect free. Now, what is a side effect? Those of you who have experience with functional programming, maybe Haskell, Lisp, or functional in Java or Python, or something, you must have come across this term called side effects. Basically, any time a function changes anything, any state outside of it, that's a side effect. For example, if a function updates a global state, if a function updates a pixel on the screen, if it changes the Bluetooth settings as Anupam had done, all these things are side effects of a function. So if your function has side effects, it is inherently difficult to test. For example, we have this function here called save headers. This is basically now when I do my login and I come back, I'll get the headers from my API call that I need to save in a local storage. Now, when I'm updating them in a local storage, it's a side effect. And what I'm doing here is I have a wrapper around my shared preferences, which is called user header store, and I'm sending my client ID, access token, and user ID in these. Now, if I had to test this code, I will first need an implementation of shared preferences. So I'm not sure if Google Electric provides that or not, but otherwise I have to use an instrumented test for that. And to check if it actually worked or not, I'll have to go inside my local shared preferences and then check if those variables were set or not. So it is now testing not just my business logic, but it is also testing things like if my shared preferences is working correctly or not, if I have permissions to write or not, things like that. So it's not really a good unit. We cannot really write a good unit test for this. Now, to fix this, one solution would be similar to what we did before, dependency injection. Now, we've already seen that. But there's one more way we can, for dependency injection, without using the framework, what we would have to do is we would have to create an interface, we would have to create that class that does. So we'll have to write some extra code for that. But with Kotlin, there's another way to solve this problem without actually creating those extra classes. And that's called higher order functions. So Kotlin is also, finally, we have a functional programming language on Android. So Kotlin allows for higher order functions. So I can write this code in something like this. So with headers, I'm passing three different functions. These functions take string and return unit, basically do nothing. And then I'm just invoking these methods inside my save headers function. Now, if I had to write a test for this, all I have to do is like create these three functions, which basically, instead of writing to a shared preferences somewhere, just update my local variables here and then call the save headers function and then assert that my local variables have actually been updated to what values I had set. So thereby writing a test which is reliable, which is fast, which is easy to write and read. So higher order functions. So some rules of thumb for writing code which is more testable. Write deterministic code. Minimize your side effects. In a sense, write pure functions. But there lies the catch. Can we completely get rid of side effects? I mean, that's just impossible because all our applications have to interact with users, have to show output to the users, right? So, and all of those are side effects. So, how do you do that? Basically, as much as possible, extract all of your side effects to, I'll say, your activity or your fragment or your view. So your view models and your, whatever your business logic is, view models, presenters, whatever. Make that as much side effect free as possible, and your activity, which is inherently displaying things and made for that user interaction, try to keep all of your side effects to that activity. Some red flags for identifying that you are writing code which is not testable. If you're using static properties and fields, something like global settings dot sound enabled, that is updated in some other method and then used in some other method. Don't do that. It's a very bad practice. I've seen innumerable Android developers do this. Using singletons, it's a very popular Android practice. It was especially popular before we had dependency injection frameworks. Now, singleton here, I do not mean single instance of an object. I mean the singleton pattern. So, for example, local storage dot instance dot update username. Now, that is bad. Using single instance of an object that in earlier days we used to do by instantiating an object in your application class, and now that's being done by dependency injection frameworks. That is fine. But using these singleton objects, that is bad, because then it's very hard to write tests for these. And then static methods, just like static fields, static methods are bad. How do you write tests? It's not possible. So that's a little bit about writing testable code. And now over to Niharika for a quick demo.
Whenever we do unit testing, we can do two ways. With normal software testing process, we write code and then we write the unit test there. Other is, what is an ideal approach is, which we don't get time to follow, or they are, as we are working in startups, we have bi-weekly sprints, or we have to release features as soon as we can. So there are many other reasons, so we are not able to follow this approach, which says you should write the test first. Based on those tests, write your code so that those test cases pass and design and develop your feature. So this works like this is the TDD cycle. We write all the use cases. As if I talk about login, this is my login application. This is my login application. This is a sample. I have to log in through email and password. And I have to be redirected to my home screen. What possible test cases you can write from this? Let's say I am your product manager, and I am saying that you have to develop a sample app in which you will be doing login and you will be displaying some list of items there, two actions there. So this is the first screen there. How are you going to implement this? If I am asking, what test cases can we have here?
Everything is blank.
Password must be 8 character or no. There should be one special character and one capital.
Yeah, that check is
proper internet connection.
We will be seeing the login success and failure case.
Yeah. Question.
Yeah.
The thing you're asking is, isn't it an integration test?
What possible test cases you can write from this feature?
If you're talking about the screen.
Right now, before the screen.
The question is, what are the possible unit tests for this particular screen?
If it's visible or not, plus then if the text is and the text are displaying or not, and if it's displaying the right thing or the password and that thing, and that button can have its own test, right? What's the background, the text and all that, then
let's skip the instrumentation tests that will be running on the device.
Is it the fields are not empty and they are not null, these things, I'm getting the objects, and then on interaction, the event I want to fire is getting verified or not.
So user interaction is basically like entering fields, clicking buttons. But unit test will write for things that happen after the user clicks on this button, login button. Right? Because that's when our functions in our view model, in this case, will be fine.
Yeah, so we are testing right now the presenter and view model logic, the business logic here. So we are not covering those UI and UX tests. We will cover that in instrumentation test if we are writing them. So we now know what all are the possible test cases here. So what PDD cycle says, write your test that will surely fail as you haven't written anything in your presenter view models, right? After that, write the code to make those test cases pass. You have written the conditions, arranged all the conditions, acting on that, and after that, you will be having some expected result. So based on that, you will be writing some production code, which will go live. And maintaining, now your test cases will pass. After those test cases are getting passed, you can do more refactoring. You can clean up, you can have more, you can make your views and presenters more architectural, you can consider more architectural patterns to be followed. So this always work as red green refactor. But ideally, if we don't get time to follow this, we are writing some feature and we then write the test cases there.
So when we say that let's do the RGB philosophy or the system, now the question comes that since I do not have any code right now, how do even I write failing tests? So what I usually do is I'll think of all the possible scenarios that there are. So for example, we just brainstormed what all different test cases we have to follow. And since I do not have any functions that I know that I'll be testing or anything, I'll just write simple test cases with descriptive names that tell me what is going to happen in those. And then I just have an assert statement that's failing. So I have my failing test cases now. And then as I write my code, as I have my functions, then I'll keep updating my tests simultaneously so that I'm calling those functions and then my test cases are failing. And then I'll make those changes to my functions so that my test cases pass.
Okay, so this is our test class where we had some test cases. We just discussed some test cases. So let's have some code for that. You can write your classes under your test folder, under your source, under then the test folder there. After that, we were talking about the annotations we are going to use. Whenever we run any test, there is some runner required there. You will be specifying that runner in this annotation at the rate run with. Why am I using power mock runner? I will describe that. Now, we already talked about the feature from power mock, as we can mock the final classes with static methods, final classes, final methods there. So we are going to use power mock here. That's why I have written power mock runner in run with. So that all the test cases will run through power mock runner itself. And my utility class is having some static methods there. So I will be using that and I have to mock that static class in my test here. I am just testing my view model. I don't care about the other classes. So I will be mocking every other dependency out there. Let's say I was using this utility class in my view model and I run my test. test cases will fail, even if you are mocking that utility class there with class not prepared exception. You have to prepare those classes, you have to mock those classes with jetting methods, so you have to prepare those classes as power mock have to prepare those classes for mocking. So you have to specify all those classes using this annotation, @prepare for test. Any final class, class with final methods, class with static methods, you have to specify here.
I have one question from my side. Like utility class have some other objects. They need some other objects. So again, power mockup will do that.
Yeah, you have to specify those classes too.
Also, yeah.
Yes. Like if you are using some Android dependencies as text utils or these classes, you have to specify those classes too. If your external dependency is using some other class that is with some final methods, static methods, you have to specify those too.
In this class, ma'am, or in utility method class?
Yeah. Okay. Prepare for test. So we have before class and after class annotation. These work just once. As like, if you are running all your tests, this will run once before your test. Before class will run before your old test, and after class will run before all your tests are completed. And if you have to do something as like some resetting some values or initializing some values for once, you can specify in these functions. And so now we have this annotation @mock. Everything you are going to mock, you have to use this annotation there, @mock. So now, with view models, you are working with live data and observer states, right? So for that, I have to mock the observer states too, as I will be verifying the if the state is getting posted, that post value is working or not, the states are getting changed or not. So I will be mocking the observer states. This is my view model which I will be going to test. Now, what is this for? You are using live data that will be working on some background executors. And those background executors are working on some other thread. Now, if you want to swap your background executors and want to work them synchronously, we can use this instant task execution rule class. That is just for testing purpose only. Which swaps your background executor used by your architecture components so that we can run them synchronously. As we are using coroutines for server operations, so we have same as like we had that background swap background executor. We have another rule for coroutine test rule. For coroutines, we have test coroutine dispatcher for lazy and immediate executions of coroutines. And we are swapping this background executor with this class. And this is getting used for our operations mocking here, server operations. Rule annotation specifies that before every test, this will be going to run, and after, in my instant task execution class, I can see the starting and finished methods there. If we are specifying anything with @rule, that starting and finished will run after each and every test there. If you are setting something as I'm setting some executors there, you have to reset them again. So this will be running after each and every test there. different difference between at the rate before class and at the rate before. Before class will run just once before every test. Before will run with each and every test. This will run if there are four tests in your class. It will run before every test. This will run four times. There. I have done some. I have mocked the utility class I needed. Mock static is for mocking those static methods there. Now this is my test. Checking if email is invalid, I am showing some error there that you I am posting some posting some value that this is an invalid state. I have mocked my service util there. So there was a difference between mocking and stubbing. If you are mocking something, that just means you are mocking that with a null or default values there. And stubbing is a kind of mock with which you are returning some specific value like this. When service util, I am calling this, I am having a server call here, authenticate, then return this. A login model object I am returning as in success call. So this is called stubbing. And mocking is just you are taking some object to return some null or default value. Here, this is just mock, and if you are returning some specific value, this is called stubbing. After arranging all my necessary conditions, I am acting on some. I am doing the login operation. After that, this is assert. I am checking if I am getting the state I wanted there or not. So, with observer states, you can see. For email invalid, I am posting this email invalid state. So if I run this test, this gets run like this. You'll be seeing the output here in your run. After that, after all your interactions has been made, you can have this verify no more interactions. As now I am done, if someone other is including something, this is really helpful as if another some other developer comes in and do some changes in your login and your login test fails, as must be they have included some other method or some calls there or observed some other states. So this will help out you here as you wanted. There should be no interactions, but they have added something more. So with every test, you will be having this. Now, one thing is there as you can't mock the final classes, right? And in Kotlin, all the classes are final by default. With Power Mock, you can do that. I run this class, as all my classes are in Kotlin. An exception as cannot mock or spy final classes. If you are mocking some Kotlin class, like we have this these service util there, and these classes, these are written in Kotlin, so you will be getting an error as cannot mock or spy final classes. For that, Mockitor 2 has provided this mock maker inline. You have to put this under your test folder, test resources, Mockitor extensions, and this file there. If if you're writing this, whenever your test runs, this will remove all your final as a prefix from and make those classes and non-final there for your test purpose only. This we have other test cases as password is valid or not, email and password are valid, and then do the login there. One thing was there when we talked about the Mockito features, as how many times your function is getting invoked, verify the number of invocations. So I have passed this times 2 there, verify the state times 2 on change. Everybody can see that. So, as you can see, I have called this mock observer stage 2 times. First for validation, as I was resetting up the errors I was showing on the screen. And after that, I am posting the value as success so that user can redirect to home screen. So this is getting called 2 times. So that so this signifies that you can verify the number of invocations for your method. And with this also, you can verify the order of invocations, the order in which the methods are getting called. So yeah, these are the test cases. And you can write any kind of test, any difficult or easy test cases with these annotations.
Just to elaborate on these test cases and how we're able to say that we have covered all of our scenarios. So with MVVM architecture, our view, as everybody mentioned here, is just basically reacting to different states and displaying things there on screen, right? So all we have to now test is in our view model, based on whatever user interaction was given, that we'll set up in our app. Right? Are the live data acting, updating accordingly? And if they are, that means our view will update accordingly. So we do not have to really test the view interaction now. So instrumentation tests are gone. All our business logic we can test as part of a view model itself. So, and the best part I feel about MVVM architecture, the way it has been implemented now, is that there's only a one-way flow of data. So there's no cross-dependency, circular dependencies anymore. So my view model may be depending on some other classes, but my view model doesn't know anything about the activity. And the activity knows just about the view model and not anything about anything else. So there's only like one single chain of dependencies, and the flow of data is in one direction. So if you test your view model, then you effectively test all of your edge cases for your activity.
Like you said, we have a class which is under test, so it's class under test. That contains some private functions.
Mm-hmm.
So how will we are approaching that key, it's verified key, it's, because if it's something private, we are not exposing it to outside world.
Mm-hmm.
But still we want to get it verified key, it's been working correctly.
So private function is inherently used inside that class only, and it will be used by another function that is exposed to the outside world.
Yeah.
So you just test the outside world function that is exposed to the set. Whatever is private to that class doesn't really impact.
Yeah, when we are writing retest, we are trying to narrow down other things, the kind of functions, and we are trying to check out the scope mein we are doing the right thing.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are consuming some private function, how I can figure out ki this private function is giving me the right output, which is plugging right key in the public thing. So
this is a great gray area. This private functions, they are as an outside class. I'll never know what all private functions. It's not part of the API interface that that class exposes. So we test what a class exposes to the outside world. Nothing else. Any questions?
Has TDD slowed it down?
No, actually. So I'll give you an example. The many times that what happens is I have to write a complex function for a class. For example, recently I have this model class in my code where so a class has many parents and then they have many parents. So there can be an infinite chain of parents. So I had to verify that, and then I wrote a function that gives me a subset of parents from all that entire chain. So it had a lot of complexities, and I had to write that function with considering all the edge cases and be confident that it will work perfectly. Now, one way I could do that was write a function and then create some sample data and run that code repeatedly. What I ended up doing was I just wrote a test for that, and all the edge cases that I could think of, I added in that test, and I just kept on modifying my code and not actually running that code in an emulator or in some IR interpreter, but just running my test, and it was super fast. It didn't slow me down. And that is one particular use case where it was a very specific model function that I had to test for. But cases like these, where we are writing tests for the entire view model, I think it will perhaps add some extra effort at the beginning, but in the long run, it really helps.
And it just takes 3 to 4 hours. If you are experienced on these writing unit test cases, it just takes 3 to 4 hours.
Is there any kind of strategy you guys normally use to write out tests? For example, bottom down, down up, or random?
Mostly random. But unit tests are, again, we're not writing integration tests. We're just writing small. So whatever edge cases that we can think of, we keep adding those. Whenever there's an issue that comes up, we'll immediately write a test for that.
Okay. So, when we are using mockings, right, aren't we creating mini integrations itself?
Yes, in a way.
So, how we are making sure that the module which is going to get integrated by dependency injection or any other way is giving me the right values. That's not
so. I'll test that separately. I'll test this separately. I'll write complete tests for my the module that is being injected.
We can have interactive testing, repository testing too. But if we are focusing on one class at one time, you should focus on that. So we are assuming that every other external dependency is working. We have uploaded this sample on this GitHub link, and when I started doing unit testing through MVVM and view model, I found some issues there. So I have wrote an article for that, and you can find on this thing.
We'll be sharing all the slides for all the talks here at one email through the entire group. So and the videos as well.
Last thing. If I do some async call or last computing call, will that test will go out of bound key the time which you are as an
indicator? For that, I have used that rule. Okay, I will be running everything synchronously, and I am working those classes really in view models. As if you are having some network calls, so you are just moving those tools. As I know ki this class will be returning this observable single any object you are having there. So I will be returning that. So I'm assuming that will be working. And for that, to make run those in test, we are having some rules ki this will be running on our executors. The executors we provide synchronously.
Does that answer your question? Anything else? So after our talk, everybody, before writing your functions, just think about whether I'm write, what I'm writing, is it testable or not? Can I perhaps write it in a way that makes it more testable, makes it deterministic, makes it pure, without side effects? I think that would be a good good use of our time here. And, it will have had a good impact. So just whenever you write a function next, just give it a thought, whether I'm writing it in a way that it is inherently more testable. And if you are able to write tests before actually writing your code, that would be amazing.